Welcome to the secret world of Frank Zappa. This is Jazz from Hell. Good evening, I'm Charles Shaw Murray. Welcome to the second programme in this series, in which we mark the 10th anniversary of the death of one of the most extraordinary musicians of the 20th century by exploring a vital, though neglected, aspect of his work, his bizarre relationship with jazz. Tonight, I'll explore some of the ramifications of Zappa's extensive use of a musical form he always said he disliked, and I'll investigate the inner workings of Zappa's various bands, looking at how the music was created in rehearsal, in the studio and on stage, and the crucial role his sidemen played in his creative processes.
I've often thought that he, like, I'd say Duke Ellington, was a band leader that would build his arrangements around the strengths of the players that he had in the band and feature them as such.
He really played the band as an instrument.
He would just make it up while he was doing it, and he was so in touch with that creative part of himself that he could do that.
And there was always a section in the shows where each of the musicians was usually allowed to express themselves, or espresso themselves, as Frank would say.
Make a jazz noise here.
Some musicians are born to jazz. Others achieve it, and others still have jazz thrust upon them. Zappa landed firmly in the third category. As we discovered last week, Zappa began hiring trained musicians from the jazz and classical worlds comparatively early in his career as a band leader, mainly because the original Mothers of Invention, who were basically a rhythm and blues band, lacked the musical resources to perform Zappa's more complex compositions in the way he wanted to hear them. The first responsibility of a band leader is to find musicians who can perform the music properly, but the second, an equally important facet of the band leader's art, is the ability to discover what each musician is good at, and to tailor the form and the content of the music to showcase those particular skills. In Zappa's case, he discovered that, by 1969, he had some first-class jazz soloists in his band. To waste those talents would have been foolish, and Zappa was no fool. Securing the services of the best sidemen in the business is only the beginning. Next, you need to teach them your music. Zappa's rehearsals were musical boot camp of the most grueling variety. Here's guitarist Adrian Ballou.
We rehearsed a good 8-10 hours a day, 5 days a week, in a very large film studio where they used to make Laurel and Hardy films. Now, that was 5 days a week for 3 whole months before we ever stepped on a stage and played a note for anyone. In that time, I think we covered about 5 hours of material, and a lot of it was new.
To take some of the weight off his own shoulders, Zappa would appoint one of his musicians to be the Klonemeister, a clone of Zappa himself, that is. The Klonemeister would take over some of the responsibility of running the rehearsal before Zappa himself would arrive to, as he sometimes said, put the eyebrows onto the music. Bassist Arthur Barrow was one of Zappa's Klonemeisters, and here he explains a typical routine.
I would go in and run the rehearsal for the first, say, 4 hours, and then maybe take a break or something, and then Frank would come in for the last 4 or 5 hours, whatever it was going to be. I had a little cassette recorder, and I would record the rehearsal, most of it. If Frank would come in and he'd start getting creative and telling people, well, you know, you do this here, and you do that there, and I need the giggle stick here, and... And so I'd have to, you know, get this all captured on tape. Then I would go home at night and sit down with the tape and a notebook, and I'd write down everything. Okay, Ed was supposed to do this here, Tommy was supposed to do this here, and my own parts too. You know, I'd have my own parts to practice and sing. And then I would come in the next day, and so we'd you know, go over the tune that Frank had worked on the day before, and we'd go through it. And of course, everybody'd forget what Frank had told them. I said, no, remember, you're supposed to do this, and you're supposed to, oh, yeah, and do it. Just drill them on it over and over till that got ingrained, you know. And then Frank would come in, and then he'd start, you know, working on it some more. And then he'd, you know, change, oh, no, don't do that. Do this instead. And he'd change everything. So everything I'd drilled him on, he's changing by the evening, so I'd have to go through it all again. So it definitely kept me busy.
Extensive rehearsals weren't necessary simply because Zappa's music was so extraordinarily complex and intricate. An awful lot of Zappa's compositional activity would actually take place during those rehearsals, using the band as a compositional tool. Pieces might be composed from scratch, elaborated, or drastically altered in the rehearsal hall.
For rehearsals, he had in addition to his guitar in the front of the stage, he also had just a little Rhodes piano there, so he could come in. He came with this little vamp that was like C with G augmented back and forth. And so he'd kind of teach us that, oh, play this little vamp here, and then he'd like pick up the guitar and he'd like make up some melody, some nutty little melody, and then, you know, Tommy'd learn that, and then he'd stop and make up a new part, this another section, and work it out and show Tommy the chords and just kind of build it up that way and just make up new little parts. And that, in a way, was almost more fun than anything to see. I mean, there was nothing to compare with the thrill of getting on stage in front of, you know, 3,000 or 4,000 people and that. But boy, there was really something special about those rehearsals.
Consistently, that was my favorite period.
Keyboard player Tommy Mars.
I like to call it like the test tube period. To be part of a process with a genius of his ilk, you would think, God, he really has a lot of respect for all of us, that he's letting us find our way. He would give us a brief little road map in this road rally we were on, and we'd be finding our way, and he'd be like, you know, we'd be the horses in the chariot, and he'd just be, you know, with the whip. His mind was going a million times a minute, and anything could happen.
Moggio from the album Man from Utopia. Again, the fact that so many of Zappa's players came from the jazz world was of crucial importance, because where else could he find musicians with the particular skills to make this method of working possible? From the early 70s band that also featured virtuoso trombonist Bruce Fowler, here's drummer Ralph Humphrey.
He knew that he could ask anything of us, and that we would do it. So he would say to Bruce, you know, play this crazy trombone line, and Bruce would play it. You know, how many guys are able to do that? You know, understand what Frank is wanting him to do, and then understanding that, well, it happens to be 17 notes, you know, rather than, you know, a usual, you know, rhythm. So Frank had full rein with what he wanted to do.
If you're going to write for human beings, you have to know what they can do and what they can't do. And then you have the option of pushing it a little bit, writing something that's just slightly more difficult than you would imagine a human being was capable of doing. And if you get lucky, you'll find people who can rise to that occasion. And I've been lucky enough to find certain musicians in the last 25 years who managed to play some things that other people would think of as impossible.
He would just like challenge you and push you, and it's like, well, can you do that? What can you do that in double time now? What can you do it to an octave up? What can you do that and sing at the same time? What can you do that and sing and dance at the same time? And you know, just push you and push you and push you and just see what your absolute limit was. And you know, and I found myself doing things that I wouldn't have dreamed I could have done.
but they never would have done it if somebody hadn't thought up this impossibility and not only asked them to do it, but paid them to do it.
It's like being in a university or something. We called it Zappa University, kind of jokingly, when we were in the band.
And the torture never stopped. Even when the band had clawed its way out of rehearsal and onto the stage, Zappa would still feel free to turn on a dime if inspiration struck, confident that his musicians would follow him. By a process he called conduction, he was able to change every aspect of a piece, altering not simply volume and tempo, but even style. In extremis, he would even create an entirely new composition in real time. Here's Tommy Mars.
He really played the band as an instrument. We had to be responsible for probably, I would say, in one tour, between 15 and 20 hand signals that would mean something, either tunes or time signatures or environments.
For one, if he pulled up on his hair, that meant launch into a reggae version. And if he kind of made like he's playing like heavy metal air guitar, you know, that would mean like launch into a heavy metal version of it, you know. Or if he'd kind of go bow-legged and bounce up and down, that meant to go into like a country version of it. And, of course, then there's the signals, like if he'd go like this, like make his hand like a C, that meant play like C6, you know, a real corny C chord, or hand it like this in an A frame, and that would mean play A, and sometimes he'd go A and C and A, just silly stuff like that. And so all this stuff that sounded like this arrangement that had been carefully worked out and rehearsed was just done off the top of our heads. And that was one of the great things about that band, is like there was such a high level of musicianship that... That he could do things like that.
It must have been so gratifying for him that we were all there for him. We wanted to make it sound the way he heard it in his mind, because it was a fantastic soundscape that we were creating. And let's face facts. Jazz, if someone were to ask me what an essence of jazz is, it is that spontaneity. That's got to be part of it. And if that is, Frank was utilizing it to its max.
Tommy Mars. Of course, the ability to flawlessly execute ludicrously difficult composed passages and function comfortably in a variety of styles wasn't all Zappa demanded from his musicians. Also mandatory was the ability to deliver, on cue, a bravura solo capable of generating a standing ovation. Mid-70s live recording of Black Napkins with Mike Brecker working out on tenor sax.
He always made it a point to feature the musicians in the group.
Bassist Patrick O'Hearn.
And there was always a section in the shows where each of the musicians was usually allowed to express themselves, or espresso themselves, as Frank would say. It's funny because he knew how much I wanted to play too, and he would always give me a shot at stepping out and improvising. But he would tease me about it, too, and I recall him saying straight away when we were just going out on the road, he said, Pat, just remember this. All the world hates a bass solo. Keep it short and sweet.
Patrick O'Hearn's sweet, but not particularly short, solo from The Ocean is the Ultimate Solution. But even here, there was an essential paradox in Zappa's attitude to soloing. He encouraged his musicians to blow their heads off, but he also teased them about their propensity for what he called noodling. The musicians never quite knew which reaction they were going to get from Zappa, as Tommy Miles explains.
I was amazed that a couple of times, actually, like the next day in the limo, he would say, geez, nice work on that solo last night, Mars. You know what I mean? He'd actually remember it. And occasionally I would look at him, and usually he had that one stone-faced look with his cigarette on the stool, and you'd think he's probably thinking of some symphony he's writing. He's not really. You'd notice him when other people were playing. And I remember a couple of times when I looked up, and he was like looking right at me, and really he was into it, you know. And you just never knew with Frank either, because sometimes when you thought you were hot as hell, he'd just like brush you off. I could never figure him out. I just love that, the mystery of Frank.
As we heard in last week's program, Zappa's public comments about jazz were intensely disparaging. Some of his sidemen felt that they couldn't even mention the J word to him.
I can never, ever remember once discussing jazz with Frank. It was like a flavor of a food that you wouldn't serve to him. Yet, it was all around the atmosphere. The way we talked as musicians, we're all, most of us, I would say every year I was in the band, at least two-thirds of us were jazzers, or maybe three-quarters, I would say 75% of the band were jazz players, sometimes 100%. And so we'd have our own lingo and our own way of approaching things, and Frank, you could tell that he was entertained by it, but I don't ever once remember discussing jazz with Frank. Sure, we talk about the solos, how they were structured, you know, the technical part of it. But I don't ever, you just didn't do it because you knew that he didn't dig it. He frowned upon it, at least on the surface.
So what precisely was the nature of Frank's jazz problem? Don Preston, Ralph Humphrey, and Tommy Mars offer some suggestions.
One thing is that I always felt, and a number of other of us guys felt, that he was slightly jealous about the fact that, and which wasn't true, but I think that he felt that the audience responded more strongly to one of us playing a solo than they did to the actual end of the song. And that kind of upset him a little bit, you know. Oh, we were just noodling, but the audience thought, you know, this.
One of the reasons is that he loses control if he accedes to a jazz conviction. And being that people would know him for rock, he wouldn't have to be lumped with jazz, you know, even though it's all around. I think it was a control issue with Frank.
I'm wondering perhaps if it's that he had a dislike for a particular kind of jazz, like, for example, bebop, you know, because it just took itself way too seriously. You know, so he was going to use jazz, but use it in his way so that it would work and he would be okay with it.
Support for Ralph Humphrey's argument can be found in the only Zappa composition explicitly dedicated to a jazz musician. He didn't choose to celebrate Charlie Parker, John Coltrane, or Duke Ellington, but the distinctly left-field genius of Eric Dolphy, whose Out to Lunch remains to this day one of the most original recordings in jazz. The Eric Dolphy Memorial Barbecue first appeared in 1970 on Weasels Ripped My Flesh, but Zappa's most jazz-oriented touring ensemble revisited the tune in 1988. Here's trombonist Bruce Fowler.
Dolphy is a masterpiece, I think. It's an unbelievable tune. And it's a jazz tune, you know, it's kind of an odd jazz tune, but it really is a jazz tune. I suspect he's listened to Eric Dolphy some. We played these more like jazz in 88 than they did early on, that's for sure. Then it was really like a jazz tune. But in the first version, I don't think they could play that. So they just did this version that's kind of a funny version. I thought that it's a serious tune. I you know, to me, it's not a comedy tune. Although it sounded kind of like a comedy tune when he did it first. But, you know, the quality of the tune kind of won out.
The Eric Dolphy Memorial Barbecue from the album The Best Band You Never Heard in Your Life. Zappa considered himself first and foremost a composer, and in the hierarchy of the classical world, the authority of the composer and his representative on stage, the conductor, is absolute. Musicians, Zappa believed, have nothing to do until a composer provides them with music to play, except to noodle. Jazz completely upends this hierarchy by asserting the primacy of the improvising musician over the composer. In this respect, jazz and classical music today represent utterly different philosophies, and there was no doubt on which side of the divide Zappa stood. The modern-day composer not only refuses to die, but refuses to cede more than a fraction of his authority to the musician. Nevertheless, Zappa's music provided a unique experience for the musician. After you've performed his music, everything else is just toothpaste.
It takes the fear out of reading, takes the fear out of performing. It really gives you some serious chops. It makes me a better player for the experiences that I had there. And completely unafraid of any music that anybody would put in my face.
God, I mean, how lucky and fortunate I was to have that experience, you know. Since we played with Zap, it's almost become like guys who played with Miles. It's like a... definitely something I'm proud of. So I think today, with musicians today, it's like, with Frank being gone, I don't know of anything that can compare to that, that a young musician could go through to have that kind of experience. And I don't, if it's out there, I don't know what it is. Gosh, it was a lot of fun. I sure do miss it. Damn.
In the next program, I'll be examining Zappa himself as a soloist. With his guitar strapped on, was he performing the miracle of instant composition? Or was he simply indulging in a spot of his own noodling? Make up your own mind next week. But until then, the secret word is shut up and play your guitar.
Eat That Question, ending this week's Jazz File. Jazz from Hell was written and presented by Charles Shaw Murray and produced by Robert Abel. And the series is a Something Else production for BBC Radio 3.